So a lot of data to digest this week, and joining us to help us do that is Davy Roets. He's chief economist at the Efficient Group. Davy, have you digested all this data yet?
No, it's going to take some time. quite a lot of numbers.
Perhaps starting with the current account deficit, because that's really what the market was looking for this week. Rose from 2.9% in the fourth quarter of last year up to 4.6% in the first quarter of this year. And that seems to be a little bit higher than the market was expecting.
Certainly higher than what we've expected. I think perhaps if you go into the numbers, you will find that part of the reason is because we are exporting less, of course, but also because consumption expenditure in South Africa is surprisingly strong. So the demand side of the economy is better than what we've expected so far. So essentially people are just buying more stuff, importing more stuff, and that leads to a current account deficit.
Is it a concern for you at this level?
Not at the moment, but a current account deficit in excess of economic growth will eventually become a problem. We've had quite large capital inflows, so it's fairly easy to fund a current account deficit of 5%, but it's not sustainable. And remember, if you have a current account deficit, currently about 4.5% in South Africa, it means that you consume more than what you produce. So we in South Africa are very much focused on consumption. While other countries like the Chinese, for example, their growth really comes from the production side. So the larger our current account deficit, the more we actually support the Chinese economy in a way. Not a problem at the moment, but certainly not something that is sustainable.
And do you think it was heartening to see that household spending is picking up, that consumption is picking up? Because of course we know we had that very low current account deficit at the end of last year because there was just no demand in the economy.
Yes, most definitely. I think the signs that we see some demand coming through in the economy is something to be quite happy about. That also, by the way, means that the Reserve Bank is unlikely to cut interest rates with demand really coming to the fore. But again, if you go into the numbers, you will see there's some reasons for that. One obvious reason is that motor vehicle sales was quite strong in the first quarter and probably going to be in the second quarter as well. I think from the third quarter, we're probably going to see a bit of a slowdown.
Post-World Cup,
yes. So that's part of the technical reason behind that. But overall, one should be quite happy but to see an increase in consumption expenditure.
Okay, you said the Reserve Bank unlikely to cut interest rates. Of course, we had that jobs number out earlier this week, which was a repeat of a number we already had a while back. 79,000 jobs lost in the formal non-agricultural sector in the first quarter. Of course, we've got consumer inflation right in targets, coming down quite nicely, 4.6%. Don't you think that gives a little bit of scope for an interest rate cut? Do you think we need an interest rate cut?
I don't think we need an interest rate cut. I think we interest rates in South Africa, and we've discussed this before, is interest rates in South Africa are very low. It's high compared to the Americans and high compared to Europeans, but we're an emerging economy. We still have inflationary problems in South Africa, and I'm afraid we're probably going to have some more inflationary problems going forward. In fact, if you analyze the PPI data, the consumer or the production side, production inflation, if you like, in South Africa, you will see a lot of price increases are starting to come through. Like, for instance, the electricity price increases, and broadly, because of the commodity price increases, we see some pressure on the production side as far as prices are concerned. That will eventually be passed on to the consumer as well. In the meantime, we have wage increases. Currently, we know what's going on Eskom, for instance, and I'm afraid those sort of wage increases will eventually also be passed on to the consumer eventually in South Africa. And the unfortunate part about South Africa, we've got the insiders and we have the outsiders. The insiders are the people with jobs, and they get currently wage increases double, three times of the inflation rate, for instance, while the outsiders, the people without jobs, are actually kept out of jobs because of labor legislation, for instance. Quite unfortunate that the economy again lost nearly 80,000 jobs, and I'm afraid I don't see huge job creation in the second quarter, perhaps in the third quarter, we may have turned the corner.
Your view on the Eskom strike, and it looks like they are getting closer to middle ground. We know that the National Union of Mine Workers has lowered its wage demands to 9%, so not very far from the 8% that Eskom is offering. Still that housing allowance which is sitting there. I mean, do you think that we could see a strike? And if we did see a strike, it would be a quite dangerous time for the economy.
Well, you know, that's what trade unions do. They see when the opponent is vulnerable. We in South Africa certainly is vulnerable at the moment. The best time to kick your opponent is when your opponent is down.
Or playing football.
So they certainly, most definitely, using the opportunity now to try to push for that unrealistic wage increase. In fact, I think the offer from Eskom is very, very generous. 8% increase is in fact far too high as far as I'm concerned. Eskom workers are paid more on average than most other state-owned enterprises. They are certainly paid more on average than what the private sector is paid. So I think, I hope really that they get to some sort of agreement.
We've had data out of the United States this week that shows that they're not fully out of the woods yet either. Consumers are still quite vulnerable there. We saw that UK budget last week. We know about the austerity measures in Europe at the moment. How do you think South Africa is looking in comparison? What sort of message will we be taking to the G20 meeting this weekend?
We look completely different. Really completely different. And the simple reason, the biggest difference between South Africa and America and Europe is that our debt levels are so much lower. You can't keep on borrowing money if you have very high, when you have a huge overdraft already. And that's where America is. And that's where the European economies are at the moment. The very interesting thing, the political divide is coming to the fore now. And for instance, what happened in Britain just now, we had Brown, which tried to spend themselves out of the recession, and we've got Cameron now, and his approach is completely different. So who's going to be judged by history to be taking the right course? My suspicion is that the conservative approach will eventually be proved to be the right thing to do. You simply cannot keep on borrowing money. You can't just keep on spending and try to spend yourself out of trouble. The UK economy is probably going to go into quite a bad patch over the next couple of quarters, but thereafter, the economy will be out of the woods much faster, my suspicion is, than the US economy, unless they start doing something different in the US as well.
And we know there's a bit of a discrepancy between what the US would like to see at this stage and what we're seeing coming out of Europe at this stage. So we're all going to this G20 summit with our own agendas, quite different agendas in some cases. How do we find middle ground at this meeting?
Well, everybody wants everybody else to spend, you know. And I'm afraid that's not going
to
happen.
We want China to spend.
We want China to spend. We want the Germans to spend. They don't want to spend because they realize, they know what is going to happen. I think perhaps there's this ideological divide really coming to the fore, and I think politicians need to talk a little bit more.
Do you think anything productive will come out of this G20 meeting?
This is pretty much a talk shop as always, but at least they talk to each other.
Of course, ahead of that G20 meeting, we had China last weekend announcing that they were going to allow the yuan to appreciate. And of course, it has appreciated marginally from last weekend's levels, but this is something that's going to be very tightly managed by the Chinese regulators.
They will continue to do that. And a couple of months ago when we talked, we were discussing the possibility of the Chinese allowing their currency to gain a little bit. I think that they will continue to do that over the next couple of months. Of course, it's very, very tightly controlled. There are very strong capital control regulations in China, but that's very good news. That will allow the Chinese, hopefully, to reduce the huge fiscal, or rather current account surplus that they have, and add some demand to the world economy.
Do you think this was political posturing ahead of the G20 meeting?
Oh yes, most definitely, I think so. And I think they're all playing the political game. The Americans not too long ago decided not to brand China as a currency manipulator, and that gave the Chinese the opportunity to do something. So they've done a little bit, so the Chinese are off the hook for now.